The Ministry of Secondary Education has developed a distance learning platform for students of secondary education in Cameroon. A series of lessons taught by qualified teachers for secondary school students. Under the stewardship of Professor Pauline Nalovalyonga in collaboration with the Ministry of Posts and Telecommunications, CAMTEL, CRTV, and UNESCO, we are introducing distance learning as another teaching and learning method which is different from the traditional classroom setting that you are all used to. In the distance education mode, you are not with the teacher in person, so take your time, relax, listen to the teacher, take down notes and visit the following links for any questions or answers to your questions. Take it in your stride. This is Cameroon's solution to COVID-19 and beyond. Professor Nalovalyonga, Minister of Secondary Education.
Welcome to phase 3 of your distance learning session. I am Changi Pepetua, your geography teacher. We are going to have a revision for ordinary level GCE, phase 3. Our phase 3 is on practical geography, wherein we are going to have map reading and interpretation of topographic maps. What is a map? A map is a representation of all of the Earth's surface or portions of it on a plane surface. It can be on a piece of paper, it can be on a table or a cardboard paper. There are so many different types of maps. We have a weather map that shows weather conditions of a place. We have geologic maps which show rock types or the geology of an area. Vegetation maps which show the vegetation of an area, and topographic maps. Our focus at this level will be on topographic maps. What are topographic maps? Topographic maps are maps which show both physical and human features on the surface of the earth. Signs and symbols are used to interpret these physical and human features on a topographic map. Now, this is an example of a topographic map. On this map, you see signs, symbols. These red lines, okay. On the topographic map, you see lines on them. Some are red, some are blue. We also have features on the topographic map. These are the signs and symbols represented on a topographic map. For a topographic map to be seen as okay or standard, it must have the following. The title is an element of the map. It shows the name of the topographic map. It's not changing. Okay, as I was saying, A topographic map has four main elements. We have the title, like what we have on our screens. The title of this map is Ordnance Survey Map of Hope Valley and Shatton Edge. Oftentimes, they take the name of a prominent feature or a prominent settlement to give as the title of the map. There are so many other map titles that you may have seen. We have the map extract of Tavistock, the map extract of Bournemouth, the map extract of Cambridge. In Cameroon, we also have topographic maps. For example, the map extract of Manjo and environs, the map extract of Babungo and environs, the map extract of Douala. All of these are titles to topographic maps that we have in Cameroon. The next major element of a topographic map is the key. Now, as I was saying, these are some of the examples of titles of topographic maps. The next is the scale. It is a reduction of the normal size or distance on the surface of the earth that has been reduced and is represented on a piece of paper or on a sheet of paper. There are different types of scales. Scales as a representative fraction. For example, 1 in 50,000. The map scaled 1 in 50,000 or 1 over 50,000, that is as a representative fraction. We also have scale as a ratio, 1 in 50,000, 1 in 25,000, 1 in 100,000. Scale can also be represented in the form of a statement. 2 centimeters equal to 1 kilometer. That is, for every 2 centimeters on the map, it is 1 kilometer on the ground. And it can also be represented as a linear scale, a line that has been drawn and divided into portions. We have the primary division where it has been measured. For instance, here we have 0 to 1. If you use your ruler to measure, it's going to give 2 centimeters. And 2 centimeters on the map, for instance, a map of 1 in 50,000, will give you 1 kilometer on the ground. And then this is the secondary scale. These are the different scales through which we can represent features on the map to tie with those on the actual ground. The next element of a topographic map is the key. The key, remember, if you lock your door and throw the key, there's no way you can get into that room or into that house. So the key is the most important element of a topographic map. It is this key that we use to analyze the symbols, the signs, or to interpret the signs and symbols that we have on the topographic map. These signs and the key are conventional. To say that the signs, once you see it anywhere, it means the same. Now, look at how this key has been arranged. Here, you have roads and paths. When you go to your key, to your map, you can look at what is represented in the map and come to the key to get the meaning of what that sign or symbol on your map represents. We also have railway lines, you see. Then other symbols like the cross for the church, SCH for school. Then public features footpath, buildings, post office. You can name them, there are many. Vegetation is also represented. The nature of the land is also represented by way of contours. These are contours. Contours are lines joining places with equal heights above sea level. So, in a nutshell, you must be able to read and interpret your key. If not, you'll be working at a loss, because the key on a topographic map gives you all the answers to the questions that will be asked in the exams. Now, on this key, there are some conventional colors used to represent specific features. For instance, vegetation here is represented in color green. If we go to water bodies, it is represented in color blue. Roads, thick lines for roads or for communication. And then the thin red lines for contours. The last element of a topographic map is orientation. How do you position your map? The manner in which you position your map in relation to the true north. So we have the magnetic north, true north, grid north, but our focus is on the true north. How do you place it? Have you held your map the other way around? It should be upright and facing the north direction. Locating places on maps. You may be asked to locate the place, not necessarily on a topographic map, even just around us. Locate your home, locate your school. What do we use in locating places? There are a number of elements that we use to locate places. On a topographic map, we use grid references. Grid references are lines superimposed on a topographic map to show the direction of the east and the direction of the north. Let us observe this image. When we use grid references, we can locate specific squares or features within a specific square. And when we use the six-figure grid reference, we locate specific features. Now, in locating places on a topographic map, using grid references, the first one is the four-figure grid reference. Now, let us look at what we have on the board. Remember I said grid references or grid reference are lines superimposed on a map. And these lines are the easterns. The easterns are the vertical lines. These ones are the vertical lines. We call them easterns because their values are increasing towards the east. We have 01, 02, right up to 06. The nodings, the horizontal lines, these are the horizontal lines. Their values are increasing northwards, 08, 09, 10, right up to 12. In locating places using grid references, always start from the easterns. That is, you start reading from the eastern values before you move on to the northern values. Now, let us use the four-figure grid reference to locate this shape or the shaded portion on the diagram on the board or the image here. Now, I just said in locating places using the four-figure reference, we start from the eastern figures first before we move on to the northerns. Now, let us observe. This shaded portion is found between which eastern value? Or between which eastern value do we have a shaded portion? All right, it is between 03 and 04. We are going to take the smaller value of the shaded portion, and the smaller value within where this shaded portion is found is 0.3. That is our distance figure. Then we move on to the nodings. In which nodings values do we have the shaded portion? We have it between 10 and 11. We take the smaller value, which is 10. And this gives us our four-figure grid reference. So this shaded portion is found in grid square 0.3, 1.0. Now, in locating specific features, we use the six-figure grid reference. Now let us locate figure A. Remember, we start reading from the distance before we move to the nodings. Now, in which grid square do we have letter A? In which grid square do we have letter A? Pauline? Okay, we have letter A between the grid square 0.2, 0.3. We take the smaller value, 0.2. Now, how do we get the third figure of the distance? To get the third figure of the distance, we come to the square where that value is found, or where the feature is found, and divide the square into 10 units. Let us move on. Count with me. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now, try as much as possible to centralize the feature and link it faintly. You are using a pencil. Connect it faintly to the units. Now I have connected. I count from 1, 2, 3, 4. And that is how I get my third value or third figure for the sixth figure grid reference. Now, I go to the nodings section and I take the lower value within which the feature is found. And the lower value is 0.9. To get the third figure for the nodings, I come again and I divide the square 0.9 and 10 into 10 units. Count with me again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I connect again faintly and I count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. My sixth figure grid reference. 0.24, 0.96. To say that the specific location of A is 0.24, 0.96. That is how we get the sixth figure grid reference. Now, the next way through which we can locate places on a topographic map is by using the cardinal point. The cardinal point, in effect, the main cardinal points are the north, the east, the south, and the west. But in effect, there are 16 cardinal points. The northeast, the southeast, southwest, the northwest, you can begin to break north, northeast, north, northwest to come up with the 16 cardinal points. Now, how do you use the cardinal direction to get the location of a place? We use the cardinal direction in identifying the location of two places. You must be able to identify the point of origin and the other point. How do we get the point of origin? Oftentimes, we tell students or learners to identify their point of origin from the preposition from or after the place that comes after the preposition from. For example, what is the direction of your school from the hospital? What is the direction of your school from the hospital? Our point of origin is from the hospital. Now, when you are at the hospital, at the center of it, you draw a cardinal point and then you connect the hospital with it and it will give you your direction. Now, let us look at what we have here. What is the direction of point B from A? Our point of origin is A, and the point towards the point whose direction is required is B. We come to the point A, and on it we draw our cardinal point, or we superimpose the cardinal point and link it to point B. If we link it to point B, then point B will be to the northeast of point A. Now look at point C from point A. This is point C. Point C from A is to the west of southwest. So you can use the cardinal point to get the direction of a place. We can also use bearings to get the direction of a place. And with bearings, we want to find out or to identify the angle a place has with another. What is the bearing of your school from the school farm? Or the bearings of your class from the principal's office? What do we use? We use a protractor. This is a protractor. It's in the form of a semicircle and has been graduated from zero right up to 180 from the outside, and from the inside 180. If you put the two, it's going to give us 360 degrees. Now, to get the bearing of a place from another, we must identify the point of origin. To identify the point of origin, remember in direction, we said the place that comes after the word from, or after the preposition from. Now, what is the bearing of point F from point A? We are using the protractor. We place our protractor on point A so that the center of our protractor is at the center of point A. Now, we rotate the protractor in a clockwise direction. This is our point A at the center of the protractor, and then the zero, point zero on our protractor is on the north of the point A. Now, we begin to read from the figure zero and go in a clockwise direction until we meet the point or the place whose bearing we are looking for. Now, here, this is the bearing of point F, and it is 40. If you write 40, your answer is not correct. It must be expressed in degrees. So 40 degrees is the bearing of point F from A. On this other side, we have point A, and then we want to get the bearing of point H. Now remember I said you place your protractor in a clockwise direction. We have placed the protractor in a clockwise direction from 0 right up till this point, 180, but we have not yet gotten to the point H. We turn the protractor, since it is half, so as to make a complete circle. Now when we turn, we start reading from outside 0, that is 180 to the right, and then we move on. Here is point H, 130. Now, we had 180 on the right side plus 130 on the other side. That is 180 to the right plus 130 to the left. It gives us 1, 3. And the bearings of point H from A is 310 degrees. Tam tam amote tam zavike mane tam bien inyane injo bien. Measurement or map measurements. We also do measurements on maps. What kind of measurements can be done? We can measure the distance of a place. If we have to measure the distance of a place, it can either be a straight line distance or a winding distance, like what we have here. From point A, following the dots or the broken lines to point B, is a straight line distance. And from point A, following the dark line, is a winding distance. It's not straight. See how it winds, it bends from point A to B. Now, if you are asked to calculate the distance of either a straight line or a winding distance, this is what you do. Now, take a straight line distance between point A and B and a winding distance between point A and point B. Now, for a straight line distance, it's easy because you can use a ruler to measure the distance. Now, I use a ruler. Note, when you are using the ruler, make sure you start reading from 0. Because some of you are funny, you can start reading from the edge of the ruler and it will give you a wrong answer. So you measure and then you have the straight line distance. Okay, let me use this one. This one is short. Our board is big, but we have a small ruler. But on your question paper, this ruler will be okay. So we measure the distance. Assume that we have a distance of 10 centimeters on the map. Now, let us come back to the winding distance, because the formula to calculate the winding distance and the straight line distance is the same. Now, for the winding distance, you need a sharp edge of a paper or a thread. But I prefer the sharp edge of a paper. Now, this is the edge of your paper. Nothing is on it. I come to my distance. I've already marked the point A and the point B, whose distance I have to measure. Now, I place my piece of paper at the starting point and I mark it off with my pencil. When you are marking, making sure make sure that a portion of the map cuts across the paper and the map. Now, I follow the bends closely. That is where my paper has measured. I twist or I turn the paper so that I can have a straight distance. I mark and I follow the bends and the twist of maybe the river or the road. I follow the bends closely and I measure. Now, I have measured my distance on the sharp edge of a paper. I take my ruler and place it on the edge of the paper from point A right up to point B, and I read off the value from my ruler. Now let us assume again that it is 10 centimeters. Now, when this process is over, use the formula to calculate distance. What is the formula to calculate distance? Or the distance of a place? A road? A river? Okay. Now, this is the formula to calculate the distance of either a winding stretch or a straight line. Ground distance equal to distance on the map in centimeters divided by scale divided by 100,000. Distance on map, ground distance equal to distance on map in centimeters divided by 100,000 divided by scale. Now we have measured the distance of a straight line and the winding distance, and it gave us 10 centimeters. Now, to convert this into actual ground distance, what is the scale of the map? Assume that the scale of the map is 1 in 50,000. To say that 1 divided by 50,000. Now, distance on map divided by 1 over 50,000 divided by 100,000. Why are we dividing by 100,000? We are dividing by 100,000 to convert this distance on map to ground distance. And distance is calculated and expressed in kilometers. So to bring the map centimeters to ground distance, we will divide it by 100,000 because there are 100,000 centimeters in a kilometer. Now, 10, which is the distance that we had on the map, divided by 100,000. Mathematically, this sign is not correct, right? We change the sign to what? To a multiplication sign, and then we invert. 50,000 goes up, and 1 comes down. Now, let us work it out. 1, 2, 3, 0, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 1. So, the distance is 5 kilometers. Remember, we are expressing ground distance in what? In kilometers. So, your answer should be expressed in kilometers. Now, this is what we have. And that is the answer, 5 kilometers. The next is the measurement of area. Calculate the area covered by the shaded portion. We have the shaded portion. No, this is a shaded portion. To calculate the shaded portion, we would use just one method that you have to retain. The squared method, look at, the area has been superimposed by grid squares, and these grid squares have been drawn to scale. So we use the grid squared method to calculate the area. Now, how do we use the grid square method? The first thing is to count the number of full squares. We also count number of incomplete squares. Now let us count the number of full squares. We are counting together. This is a full square. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are 5 full squares. 5 full squares. The incomplete squares, let us count together. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There are 7 incomplete squares. Now, we take the 7 incomplete squares and divide by 2. This method is called the give and take method. Now, 7 divided by 2 equal to 3.5. We add the full squares to the incomplete squares. So, it's going to be 5 plus 3.5 and it gives us 8.5 kilometers or square kilometers. Remember, area is expressed in square kilometers. So our answer is 8.5 square kilometers. Number of full squares, 5. Number of partly covered or incomplete squares, 7. Adjusted squares, 7 divided by 2, and it has given us the answer, 8.5 square kilometers. Another way through which measurements can be done on a map is through map copying, where you are asked to copy the map, just like go and photocopy your birth certificate. It comes out exactly as it is. In map copying, they may ask you to copy a portion or to copy the entire map. In copying the map, you don't change anything. You measure the length, this is it. You measure the width, measure the grid square, and transfer those measurements into your answer sheet without changing them. Then you may be asked to insert certain features, for instance, the road and the railway line. Remember, you are not supposed to change anything. Now, this is the copied portion or the copied map of Hope Valley and Shatton Edge showing roads and railway. Now, when you copy your map, the grid references do not change. Copy them as you have seen them in the portion you've been asked to copy. The features you are asked to insert, let them pass through the same grid lines or grid squares in which they pass in the original map. Then you give it a title, copied portion of, or copied map of Hope Valley and Shatton. You add a key, then the orientation, and then you copy the scale. The scale of that map is 1 in 50,000, and you have not changed the scale, so it remains. The next is map reduction. Reduce the map below to half its size and insert the road and railway. Reduce the map below to half its size and insert the road and railway. Now, to reduce a map, they have told us that we should reduce the map to half its scale. You may be asked to reduce the map by 1/3 or 1/4. So it depends on the fraction in which you have been asked to reduce the map. Now, in map reduction, these are the steps you follow. You measure the length and divide by the fraction. For instance, here we have been asked to reduce the map by half. We divide by 2. Measure the width and divide by 2. Measure the grid square and divide by 2. Now, we take the new dimensions to our answer sheet and put the dimensions and copy the grid figures as they are on the original map. Now, what you would notice is that the size of the map has reduced. The features that you would insert will also reduce. The scale of the map will enlarge or will be bigger, but the features will occupy a smaller space. For instance, I said measure the length and divide by 2. Measure the width and divide by half, please. Measure the length, divide by half. Measure the width, divide by half. The grid square. Then, the scale. If the scale is 1 in 50,000, 1 over 50,000, and you are dividing it by 2, because they said that. Now, if we are dividing, remember, this sign changes. 1 over 50,000, the sign changes, 1 goes up and 2 comes down. Our new scale now will be 1 to 100,000. The next is map enlargement. Now, with map enlargement, you are to enlarge a portion of the map. You do same, measure the length and the width, measure the grid squares, and multiply by the value of which you have been asked to enlarge your map. Now, the problem is usually at the level of delimiting the portion. It's practically impossible for us to enlarge a topographic map because at the level of the exams, we may not have a paper as large as the topographic map. So oftentimes, a portion of it is given. Now, enlarge the area west of Eastern 20 and north of Northern 82 to twice the scale and insert the major roads and railway. Our problem now is to delimit the area that we are going to enlarge. They say, the question is west of Eastern 20. Now, this is Eastern 20. Where is the west of Eastern 20? We are going back this way. Now, we follow the line of Eastern 20, knowing fully where that we are going to the west and the north of Northern 82. This is the point of intersection between Eastern 20 and Northern 82. We have been asked to enlarge the portion west of Eastern 20 and north of Northern 82. So this is the portion we are going to enlarge. This portion. Okay. Now we follow the same procedure. Multiply, and then you get, this is what we have. Our scale has changed from 1 in 50,000 to 1 in 25,000. Interpreting relief forms. on a map. What is relief? It is the nature of the land, be it high or low. Now, in describing relief, three main elements can be identified, or three elements define relief. The first one is the height of the land, and the height of the land is indicated by contour values, or contours and their values. Remember, I said contours are lines on a topographic map with values on it showing the nature of the land. Other ways through which height can be identified or indicated on a topographic map is by using spot heights. A spot height is the height of the land with a dot and a value by it. A trigonometrical point, a small triangle, and a figure by it. We also have benchmarks, abbreviated BM, and a figure by it, to say that at a specific point, the height of that land is 300 meters above the sea. The next element of relief is the nature of the slope. The nature of the slope, how inclined the slope is from the horizontal. What to take note? The steepness of the slope. How do we know the steepness of a slope? The steepness of a slope is indicated by the spacings of the contours. Where contours are closely spaced, are closely packed or are packed, it shows that the slope is steep. Where the contours are spaced out, it shows that the slope is gentle. The direction of the slope, is the slope directed to the north, to the south, upslope or downslope? And then the form of the slope, is the slope concave or convex? Now let us observe this. The direction and steepness of the slope. This is the direction of the slope. The slope AB. So it slopes to the southeast. Then the steepness, spaced out contours, shows that the slope is gentle. Tightly packed contours shows that the slope is steep. The form of the slope. This is the form of the slope. This is concave, where the values are increasing outwards. This is convex. The values are decreasing outwards. Relief forms. So many different relief forms on a topographic map. How do you identify these different relief forms? We differentiate them and relate them to the different landforms around by looking at the alignment of the contours. Now look at this. This is a conical hill. Look at, that's a conical hill or a round top hill, and it is represented on a topographic map by circular contours whose values are increasing inwards. See how the contour closes up, round, almost round. That's a conical hill. The next is a plateau. Look at the nature of contours, how they are aligned. The contours are closely packed at the sides, and at the top, it closes up and widens out, giving what? A flat top and steep slopes. This is a plateau. In a situation where the plateau has so many rivers taking their rise and flowing to different directions, that plateau is referred to as a dissected plateau. If you take the case of the Adamawa Plateau in Cameroon, it is a dissected plateau because so many rivers take their rise from it and flow to different directions. A saddle, a curve, or a pass. This is what it looks like on the ground. A lowland in between two hills. And this is how it is represented on a topographic map. See, this is a conical hill where the contour closes up, spaced out contours, then another closely packed contours, and then a conical hill. This low land between is called a col, a pass. When a road passes between, it becomes a pass. We have examples of them in Cameroon. A ridge, an elongated land with peaks, valleys, or lowlands in between highlands. This is a conical hill, another conical hill, and in between it is a saddle, then a col, and a pass. We have a road that passes through, it becomes a pass. An escarpment. This is how it is represented on a topographic map. Spaced out contours, then closely packed contours, a steep face facing a lowland, a steep wall or rock mass facing a lowland, a valley and a spur. And this is how a valley is represented. You have V-shaped contours whose values are decreasing inwards. Look at 500, 400, 300, 200, that's the value of the height of the land. Then, it's still the same thing here. A spur, the values are increasing outwards. 200, then 500. If we draw a cross section of this, it's going to give us a hill between two valleys. And the hill between two valleys is a spur. Summarily, we can describe the relief using the following steps. You may be asked to describe the relief of a portion of the map or the entire map. Now, if that is asked, these are the steps you follow. Identify and state the main relief regions. Is it a highland? Is it a lowland? The next, draw a sketch map to show the major relief regions. You can make just a small sketch and divide it into the different relief regions that you have identified on the map. Now, for each of the relief regions that you have identified, give the proportion of the map that is covered by either the highland or the lowland. Give the height of the land. Look at it using the contour values, look at it using the spot height or the trigonometrical point. Then you state the type of slope. Is it a gentle slope? Is it a steep slope? The orientation or the direction. How is it oriented? Is it oriented towards the north, the south? And then the major landforms. We have already seen the different ways through which we can identify landforms on a topographic map. It may be a conical hill, it may be a saddle, a col. You can then be looking at those arranged alignment of contours and identifying the features. Now, describing the relief of a coastal region. You identify the direction of the coast. Say whether the coast is straight or not. Then you bring out some of the features along the coast. They may be erosional features or the positional features. Now let us observe this coastline, the direction of this coast, north, south, the direction of this other coast, west to east. How is this coast, what is the direction of it? Or how straight is it? This coast is straight, and this other coast is indented. Look at the indentations. Water gets into land, land projects, and this. Then the landforms. You may have capes, bays. Along this coast, you have a beach. So you should be able to identify some of the features or landforms that are found along the coast. Drainage. We talk of drilling, we are referring to what? Water bodies on the topographic map. And water bodies are represented by color blue. So go onto your topographic map and look at the blue lines. On those blue lines, you would see names of rivers and maybe pool or lakes. Then you can be talking about them. Now, in describing drainage, state whether the area is well drained or is poorly drained. Here you have to go back to your key and look at the sign to show whether an area is marshy. Now, if you see those signs on your map, it means the area is poorly drained. When those signs are absent, it means the area is well drained. The river flows in channels or it is well canalized. Identify the rivers there. Are there many rivers? Are there few rivers? If there are rivers, give the names of the major rivers. Now, when you give the names of the rivers, state the direction of flow. How do we state the direction of flow? We look at the nature of the contours. Know that rivers flow from highlands to lowlands. And if rivers flow from highlands to lowland, there you can look at the alignments and the numberings or the values of the contour and give the direction of flow of your river. Then the last thing is to identify the tributaries and how those tributaries join the main stream. Do they come at right angles? Are they parallel? Do they leave from a central point and diffuse to different directions? Pattern, the manner or way in which the tributaries join the main stream. Now, these are some examples of drainage pattern. This one is dendritic, tree-like. This other one is radial. They take their rise from a central position and flow to different directions. This one is parallel, a parallel pattern. Trees, the rivers join the main river at almost right angle. This is an angular pattern, almost circular. They take their rise and then they flow to different directions. Rectangular is another drainage pattern. And then centripetal, where rivers flow from different directions and empty themselves in one pool. Commenting on human features. Which are the human features we want to comment on, or we comment on in a topographic map? We have settlement, communication, and land use. Now, settlement, any form of human habitation. It may be a hamlet, it may be a village, a town, city. In it, we would identify the types of settlement, site and situation of settlement, distribution or pattern of settlement, the form that that settlement or settlements have taken, the functions, and we suggest possible reasons why they are where they are, or the settlements are where they are. Now, to comment on type of settlement, there are only two types of settlement: a rural settlement and an urban settlement. To identify an urban settlement, look at the way the buildings are. Are they clustered? Are they shaded? Or they are dots? If they are dots, it is a rural settlement. And if they are shaded portions, then they are urban. You can also look at the functions. If there are many functions, it means the town or the settlement is an urban, and vice versa. Now, distribution of settlement. You can identify and name the types, locate the settlement using cardinal points, and suggest reasons why those settlements are where they are, maybe at a specific location, on top of the hill, maybe at the foot of the hill. There are reasons for that. Site and situation of a settlement. Site, the actual ground, the actual environment, or the actual area where a settlement is found. And this is based on the nature of the land, the alignment of the contours, or the physical features found around the settlement. So to identify the site of a settlement, look at the physical features that are found around that environment. And how do we identify that? By looking at the alignment of the contours. Remember, we've just seen how contours are displayed on the map and what those contours mean. Now, settlement can be at the foot of an escarpment. If it is at the foot of an escarpment, it is foot of escarpment site. If it is on a coastal area or a plain, it is a coastal site settlement. It can be on top of a hilltop settlement. Along a riverside settlement. At an estuary, mouth of a river, estuary side or mouth of riverside settlement. It can also be at a confluence where two rivers meet, confluence site settlement. Now, these are some examples. Look at what is happening here. These are contours. This is a conical hill, and these are buildings here. So, if these buildings are here, spaced out contours, it shows that this settlement is sited at the foot of a hill. This other one, an escarpment, foot of escarpment settlement. This is the settlement at the foot of this escarpment. In between a gap, two conical hills and a saddle, a gap site or a saddle site settlement. This one, a spur, or if it were here, it may be a valley site settlement. Situation. What is situation? Those things that surround a settlement. For instance, somebody wants to come to your house and you have to describe the direction of your home. You will be citing those prominent things that are around that can lead the person to your home. So situation are those physical and human features surrounding a settlement that can help locate. Now, what do we use? For instance, our house is near the hospital. Our school is in between this road and that road. Those are the kind of things you can use. You can also use near. Near, or you use other features. The form of a settlement. What shape has that settlement taken? It can be a linear form, that's a line, along a road or a river. It can be rectangular, that is, it takes a rectangular form. Yes? Please? I'm getting you. Okay. Let me move on while you forward your question or your worries. All right. A settlement can be rectangular. It can be the form of a square or a cruciform or star form. Some forms of settlement. We have linear, circular, star-like. These are some of the forms settlement can take. Now, describing settlement pattern, the way the settlement has been arranged. It can be based on the spacings of the settlement. Are they close? Are they spaced out? Now, if they are close, then it is nucleated. If they are spaced out, they are dispersed settlement. And if they are along a road or a river course, it is linear. Functions of a settlement, the activities or the services rendered in a settlement. These functions or activities are based on evidence provided by the symbols on the map. For instance, educational function, evidenced by school, religious function, evidenced by church. There are so many other functions, administrative functions, evidenced by post office. Land use, what the land has been used for, the exploitation of the land based on evidence. Remember, Christians are usually asked, with map evidence, state or identify land uses. Now, which are the land uses? We have agricultural land use, evidenced by farms, plantations, orchards. Fishing is a land use, evidenced by the presence of rivers. Mining is a land use, evidenced by quarrying. So those are the, in brief, what it takes for you to answer a question in map work. Now, remember, map work is question one and it's composing. Now, let us look at this exercise. Revision question one. Study the ordnance survey map extract of Burnham, 1 in 50,000 provided, and answer the questions that follow. A. State the height of the highest point at grid point 62-31-85. Now, this is our map extract of Burnham. We have been asked to identify the highest point, and the highest point in that grid figure is 4,461 meters. The next question. The dominant woodland in grid square 63-11. Remember, you go to the grid square, look at the woodland, and go back to your key and see the type of woodland that has been described on the key. And if we do that, the woodland is the coniferous woodland. The next question, the meaning of the feature marked at grid reference 61-20-82. The meaning of the feature marked at grid reference 61-20-82. You have to go back to the map and pick out the grid values 61-20-82, and where they intersect. The feature will be found there. You pick out the feature, go back to your key to get the interpretation. And that feature is a tumulus. The next question. The nature of the slope in grid square 63-11. The nature of the slope in grid square 63-11. Look at the alignment of the contours. It will show that the contours are closely packed or are close to each other, which indicates a steep slope. The next, the length of Fairborn Railway stretching from 61-11-20 to 61-61-50. The length of Fairborn Railway stretching from 61-11-20 to 61-61-50. Remember, when you are asked to measure the distance of a place, you identify the 2 points. They have given the 2 points here, 61-11-20, 61-61-50. You mark it out. Use the sharp edge of a paper and pick out the curves and bends on the piece of paper. Then you take the piece of paper and your ruler and measure the distance in centimeters and use the scale of the map to convert the distance in actual ground distance expressed in kilometers. Now, when you do that, This is what you have. Map distance 6 centimeters. The scale of the map 1 in 50,000. The actual distance will be map distance in centimeters divided by scale. Remember, we will do some mathematical calculations, and then it will give us 6 times 50,000 divided by 100,000. Remember, we are dividing by 100,000 because there are 100,000 centimeters in a kilometer, and ground distance is expressed in kilometers. When we do that, our answer will be 3 kilometers. The next question, the bearing of Mofa, watch that, from Ferrum Station. The bearings, you use your protractor, identify the point of origin. Our point of origin is Ferrum Station, and then you get the bearing, the angle of Mofa from Ferrum, and that angle is 45 degrees. B, copy the portion of Bamount between nodings 11 and 16 and insert the water body at 6114, the A493 road, harbour, disused quarry near the railway station. Add a key, a title, and a scale. The question is copy of a map or a portion of a map. Remember, when you are copying a map, you don't change anything. Just go to the map, identify the portion you have been asked to copy, and transfer the information to your answer sheet. If you do that, this is what you would have. 11 to 16, the portion of nodings 11 to 16. Insert the road, the harbour, the water body, and the disused quarry. You put a title, a scale, and then you make a key. So when you do that, you have your marks. Now, to bring out a good copied portion of a map, or a reduced portion of a map, or the entire map, of all the times, or often times, it's good to use a graph paper, because with the graph paper, the dimensions are there. You will not take time to be measuring the distance to make it come out like what you have on the topographic map in front of you. So it's advisable to use a graph paper in drawing, in reducing your map, enlarging, or even drawing a cross section. Based on map evidence only, state what the land is used for. Map evidence. Remember, it must come from the map. Do not catalog land uses and come and pour them in the exams and think that the examiner will mark and give you marks. No. You must show proof that that land use is found on the map that you have in front of you. If you observe the map, you realize that on it, you have land that has been used for settlement, evidenced by the presence of buildings. The land has been used for lumber, evidenced by the coniferous forests. There are other land uses that you can identify. Mining, industrial land use, recreational land use, but making sure that you bring out the evidence of the land use. It must start with the land use. D, comment on the relief of the landscape. comment on the relief of the landscape. Roman 2, the distribution of woodlands. The answer, comment on the relief. Remember I said at the beginning that relief is the nature of the land. And if relief is the nature of the land, is the land high? Is it low? Now, when you identify the land or the regions, highland, lowlands, then you can now describe by locating the area where the highland is found. On the map of Burma, yes, Javi, there's a question? Ondua, I'm not getting you, please. All right. Now, on the map extract of Vermont, the highland is located to the north-northwest and the northern part of the map. We also have highland to the east, towards the south, and the southeast. The nature of the slope is steep. The highest point in that highland area is 550 meters. It has an average height of 307 meters. How do we get the average height? We identify the highest contour value, the lowest contour value, add these values and divide by 2. And then we have the average height. Then the next thing to do is to identify the features, the major features found within the highland area that you have identified. The features can be a conical hill, depending on what you have seen. It can be an escarpment, it can be a saddle, a ridge, a plateau. Now, it depends on how you have interpreted the alignment of the contours. The next is the lowland. The lowland on the map of Burmouth is a broad valley. You can identify the features that are found in that broad valley. Then, the next question was for us to describe the distribution of woodland. Woodland, forest. The forest or the woodland is dominated or is dominant in the northeast, north, and center. To say that it is not, it does not cover the entire map, it is scattered. To the north, you have woodland. To the center, you have woodland. To the northeast, you have woodland. And the main woodland is the coniferous forest found at the center. We also have non-coniferous wood in the northern part of the map. Now, we may not have had the best of it, but in your schools, you have these topographic maps. Go back to your school library, get a topographic map, and follow the steps that we have taken to do practical exercises, as many practical exercises as possible, because this section is compulsory and it is marked on 30. So if you use at least 2 to 3 topographic maps with different questions, you will be able to get out of it with no stress. For further reading, you can contact the document on your screen so as to broaden your knowledge on practical geography or map work. We have come to the end of this revision activity. If there are any worries, please let us solve them now. Yes? Oru, are there any worries that we can trash now? Please send your worries. Now, in map work, please, all your answers are found on the topographic map that you have in front of you. Do not go memorizing specific maps. Any map can come. The most important thing is to have the procedure in mind and use the procedure or the steps to answer questions in any topographic map that comes. So you should not be afraid of the size of the paper in front of you. Just take the bull by the horn and move on. Follow the steps closely. Your key on the one hand, the signs and symbols on the map, and as fast as possible, you are done. Yes, always like you have a worry. Ingrid, any worry? Abang? I'm still waiting on your questions. Bekono, no worries. All right, if we don't have any difficulties or worries, we will end our lesson here. And in the next lesson, we'll look at the geography of Cameroon. Una tege si ma tege yob, una tege minga ma tege nyom, una tege ma jang ma tege ndom, mane tambia niña ne injuk biayen, ngani bana ma tege mot, ngani la kiri wa tege ndong, esu kina bia dinkido, mane tambia niña ne injuk biayen, tam tama mote tam zabike, Tam tama tonge tam zabike tam tam tama mote tam zabike mane tambia niña ne injubia yen